today I want to cover two points. I want to be study, of course, idolatry, but I want to cover the concept of the heavenly court and the concept of heavenly kingdom. So I have a lot of material to cover. So what I do, I want to finish as much as I can. It's kind of unusually loaded with concept. So I will try to leave 15 minutes for questions. So write down if you have any questions, write it down. And then you can, when we have time to discuss it, raise it up because it's unusually loaded, not loaded in words, but in concepts. So let's start. So where are we now? We talk about the first commandment of Noah, which is not Kabbalah, it's not Zohar, it's a Talmud. It's a basic teaching of Judaism that humankind was ordered by God in Eden to have six commandments, then Noah added one and so on. So this is the first one is idolatry. We said, I'm just pick up what we learned so far in headline, in short. So we'll continue our story. So we started where is commandment number one, idolatry mentioned in Genesis? Nowhere, only in the book of Genesis, Exodus. So we have no choice but to go to the 10th commandment, which was given to Israel. And we said, it's okay to use them. And because the said commandment tell you exactly who are the idols are, what is idolatry, he said number two commandment says, thou shalt not worship other God beside me. And then not God in front of me, not God, not my son, not my mother, not my sister. And don't worship the sun and the moon, and don't carve anything you carve out, don't serve them. Don't bow to them, we discuss it. But the idolatry commandment presented there in the Ten Commandment is a negative side. I mean, don't worship other God. So in order to fulfill idolatry commandment, I need to know who God is. So I know what God is not. So Moses help us and say, it actually preceded it by God talking, the speaker talking, Ten Commandment, presenting himself. So I know now who is God. And now I understand it. Number two, he says, don't worship anything other than that. So I need, in order to fulfill number two, idolatry, I need to know number one, who is God. Now God took his time to present himself in his wisdom, in three lines, we discuss it. I am number one. Hashem Elohim, you mentioned in English, Lord your God. In Hebrew, you'd have Afke, the two attributes, mercy and judgment, Elohim and I am Hashem Elohim, who took you out of Egypt, line number three. And we said, I intervene in history, that's called kingship. I am the king of the universe who also intervene in history. I took Egypt. I took you out of Israel, out of Egypt. So that I am is the essence. The second one is the attribute. I am merciful judge and so on. And then number three, and I intervene in history. And I took you out of Egypt. We could have said other things. I bring you bread from the ground. So he wants us to, why does he make the effort to present himself in such a way, because he wants us to know him this way and to that when we approach him, we address his, our prayer and blessing, we should address him this way. That's why we bless Hashem, bless thou, you, Hashem Elohim, king of the universe, who brought bread from the earth. And all we talk about, it's all Noahide should learn how to should comply with it. You eat food, you eat bread, you bless the opportunity to get in touch with God. So you should know me spiritually. you should address me, and you should worship me this way. Now, the worshiping is more intellectual, a more emotional things, worshiping. So here is an idea that Hashem expects us to know him intellectually in this way, to address him, to understand what we are saying, to know him this way, and to worship him emotionally in this way. So there is an intellectual and emotional instruction. It's traditionally is to speak first on the emotion, on the intellectual. So what we are doing now, we start to try to understand the verse intellectually, what it means. And then in the future, once you understand what the intellectual part is, then we can talk about the part of the worshiping, the emotional. How should I relate to God? How should I sing? How should I address him? Because actually, this is the most important part, is the emotional part, not so much more than an intellectual part. So now we focus on the intellectual part. And we started last week saying that Elohim, he said the first line is, I am my asset. The second line, Hashem Elohim. Moses doesn't elaborate here what does it mean, because he knows that it's chapter one. So we open up the book of Genesis chapter one, and this is how we start now, because the head of the class, our class, is the seventh commandment through the book of Genesis. And here we are. But from now on, we're going to use the book of Genesis to go through the commandment. So it happened that we start with the chapter one through because we are looking to the meaning of idolatry. So we look to chapter one. Of course, chapter one is right there. Explain you who is God, what is name, and so on. So the name starts right away. We said last week, the verse says Elohim, he said in English, God created heaven and earth. In Hebrew, it says Elohim. So here is the same Elohim that in the Ten Commandments. Here it is, who is Elohim? He said the Almighty Judge. So you ask me, judge? Why not God? Because in Hebrew, Elohim is judge, all-powerful judge. So he created the universe for judgment, to stand judgment. So that's the basic message of first number one. So here is Elohim. Now we know what Elohim is. We need to know what the other attribute is. You'd have AFK in a minute. So Elohim is a judge. And a judge, by we said, it's a judge who look for the truth. Elohim's signature is truth. He's looking as a judge. He's looking for the fact. Did this person really kill? Did he violate the law? Did he do this? So the judge look for the truth without any other consideration. No mercy, no other argument. Don't talk to him about his youth. I want to know the facts. You did it, you kill your mother or not? You sleep with your sister or not? Or with another person, or did you embezzle your bank or not? I want to know the fact. Emet, truth. Without any consideration, without be said like water face. The second verse says, Elohim spirit is hovering over the water. So the rabbi said, his judgment is equal like water to, it penetrate everywhere like water. And it equally, it doesn't recognize a king. It doesn't recognize a simple man, a layman, a black, white, yellow man, slanted eyes, round eyes. For him, every man is equal, absolutely equal, like water face. So that's basically a headline of characteristic of Elohim. The Torah continue. We understand now the concept now. So the Torah, Moses continue now, chapter one, and is described, of course, the Elohim, what he did. He created 6 days, day by day. And finally, at the end of the Sabbath, it said there that on a day that Hashem Elohim made the earth and heaven. That's chapter 2, verse 4. So suddenly we have now another attribute. Not only Elohim, but suddenly the text says there is there is another attribute here that appears at the end of the sixth day. So Rashi, the beginning of the Torah, the first of the Torah, mentioned it. And he said, you know, there is a heavenly court here. The heavenly court is like, if you look at the chapter 1 from bird view, it starts with the Elohim. It mentioned Elohim 32 times. He made the sixth day, made the grass, he made the water, he made the fish. 30 times his name appeared very strongly. And the fact, and we know not what the Elohim is. So he appears there, the truth. Then finally, suddenly only one time, you'd have okay, appear at the end of the story. So there is a heavenly, from a bird view, if you look at chapter 1, from bird view, without going into much detail we do later, for only from bird view now. So the bird view, I have heavenly court. I have the two attributes of judgment, Elohim, appearing 32 times, and the end, the attribute of mercy, and the universe is in between the sixth day, meaning the two attributes judge the universe. So the heavenly court, so I understand now the God that has no name, when he judges the universe, including us, he sits on a throne that has the attribute of judgment, looking for the truth. And then he implies also mercy, and he judges and issue a verdict. So together, so here is I am the creator, and I have two attributes. Sometimes I see first Elohim and then mercy. And finally, they talk to each other, the two attributes. Very important point. The attribute there are talking, conversing, discussing each the verdict. And finally, they issue the verdict down there. So in that case, it's actually instruction to us, if you want. For instance, a human judge should do the same. It makes sense. A judge should sit for it. Really, the whole story makes sense. The judge should sit first and look 32 times to the truth. Nothing else but the truth. Once you find the fact, did the guy embezzle the bank or not? What? How much? What day? How come? You need to know the facts in depth. After that, I understand now he did or did not violate the law. I know what the law says, what the person deserved by the law. Without any mercy, that's a dry law. Now the judge can relax and say, okay, now let's see if I can apply any compassion and can override it or sweeten it, or actually can worsen it. If it turns out to be cruel, I actually add all the liability. So let's say a human judge. So the message here, the Torah says, let's look at it, the most important person thing that in the eyes of the Torah, that we need to emulate God. So the most important thing that we do is not only iPhone, not only to create. The most important thing that we do, you know what, is just justice, a just trial, a truthful judgment that consider all the elements, the truth, and a mercy. So if a judge come to us for election, he's on TV, he say, vote for me. Vote for me because you know what? I am Joe Biden. And vote for me because you know I am first of all, and judge, good, I will not overlook any effect. I will look at the truth. And then I will also also apply mercy. Vote for me, because I know the story. Then you vote for him. If he says, oh, I am the merciful judge, vote for me. So this guy is merciful? What about all the killers? He was sent free for mercy? He raped a person, raped a girl in our street. He come to the judge, he finds out, forgive him for mercy. No. I'm not going to vote for him. On the other hand, if the judge says, vote for me because I'm going to kill and hang all the killers without any mercy. I said, not me, not in my neighborhood. I don't want such a judge. It's nice you want, you're passionate about the truth, but we want mercy too. We want to see other considerations. So here is an instruction for us. Now we understand the concept of what? Of the chapter one, again, presented to us as a heavenly court. That's the Beit Din. Beit Din that comprise of the essence of God above, and we have the two attributes, and we issued a verdict. So it fit chapter one, the first commandment says, I am Hashem Elohim. Here it says, I took you out of Egypt. And I understand it now, I am the judge, Elohim, supreme judge, who sit on you in judgment. That's introduction to the Ten Commandments. So, you know, if you violate any of those commandments, know that I am a judge. I will judge you by this commandment. I will say, don't kill, don't steal, don't tell lie, honor your father and mother. I'll say all the Ten Commandments. But then I judge you according to, I'm going to judge you. I am the judge who is merciful and judgmental. And be sure I will look for the truth. I will also apply mercy. And finally, line number three, I will issue my verdict. So the line three is what I finally order, the verdict. That's fine. So we cover in bird view the concept of the heavenly court that Moses present here, or the Torah present here in chapter one. Clearly, that Rashi. Now, the issue is, because if you look, the story is only part of the true story. Because what is commandment number one saying? I am Hashem Elohim. It doesn't say I'm the judge. I'm the king of the universe who took you out of Egypt. I'm intervening in history. So it's a kinship here. So it's not only court theater. It's not only court theater, it's a kingdom. There is a king here. I am the king of the universe, and I rule the universe, I rule it with two attributes, and I finally issue my verdict, concept of kingship, in Ten Commandments, number one. That's basic commandment. Which means what? Which means we now understand better what is Elohim is and what is Yudhav case. It's not only mercy and judgmental. It is, they are, it's a, each of these attributes rule the world. Create it's part of the leadership of the universe. Each of the universe created the universe. In chapter number one, each of these attributes, Elohim from one side and you have from another side, each one of them contributed to the creation, and to they still rule it because it's a kingship. Kingship means I didn't leave it alone. I created it and I continue to rule over it. And I will lead it. A kingship means I lead it to a purpose. The kingship of the United States, the purpose of the United States was formed for a purpose, to give us the each individual peace, liberty, opportunity, you know, there's a spirit behind the idea of kingship, a goal, a character, a color. So each of these attributes is a way of leadership. So each Elohim is not only judge, but he is a ruler, he is a creator, he is a ruler and he is a leader. How do you know that he is a creator? That's very simple. You open up the Bible. He created it day by day, 6 days. He created the universe, six floor. Each day is a floor. He created it in his own style. He created it by the given command. Let it be this, let it be there. He didn't consult anybody. He didn't ask anybody opinion. He's a tyrant. Dictator, yes, he is. Well, a dictator has a bit of documentation, but he's a sole ruler. In Hebrew, you say levado, alone, imloch noah, awesomely alone. We sing in our siddur every day in the morning. When I wake up in the morning, Elohim, the first, he created the universe, levado, alone, he will rule the world, he ruled the universe, levado, imloch noah. He is an awesome God. He asks nobody question. Let it be fish, let it be dinosaur, let it be this, let it be this. Yeah, and he advances the universe day by day according to a plan because he lived. Not easy, we said, each attribute is involving kingship. Meaning he create, each attribute rule, and each attribute leads. So what is Elohim? Why he created the universe in 6 days? It leads to a purpose. But we can say, what is the purpose? It's to reach the seventh Sabbath, the seventh day, you want to reach the Sabbath. He created the universe to get the Sabbath. Sabbath is the last day of creation, let's say. So he lead us to a purpose. He created us, so attribute in his style. What is his style? His style that he provides. He provides food, he is fair. It's truth, the truthful judge is also fair builder. He will not create you without providing you all the talents to excel in your habitat. He gives the fish the talents to swim, give the bird to fly, he gives us the mind to excel in our, he provide. He will do fair. But he also, as a judge, because he's a judge, he also rule it when he said he create and he rule it. How does he rule it? Truthful, measure for measure. Let's say if you did something wrong, you get your punishment. You eat a wolf, eat a wolf with a sheep. The wolf, killed. The wolf itself will be killed by somebody else. You go in the forest and a tree will follow it. The universe is built in such a way, measure for measure. Look at all this, you see it. You eat and being eaten. You cause pain and one day you will get Sabbath pain. No escape. And with no mercy, because he's by definition, he's only, there is a cycle of justice. Eat and be eaten. But justice, yes, but no mercy. The animal eat without mercy. Mercy will come only to us. And come to us, it's a different story. But in the universe, 6 days, you know, Elohim, this is how he created, that's how he ruled it. And this is how he lead it. He lead it in this way toward the Sabbath. Today we are only talking about things from above. We go later on in our class, we go in a little more detail to see each one of these attributes, what it means, where the name comes from. And we learn it in detail. We're just now approaching it from bird view. We said, it's not only heavenly court, which is very simple to understand, but it's also a kingship. What kind of kingship? The creator that has no name. He created the universe, first of all, by Elohim, in the way, I mean, he sat on a throne as a judge, as an almighty judge. He created it in a fashion of Elohim create, measure for measure, truthfully, and absolute side, absolute mercy, absolute justice, no mercy. So that's Elohim. YHWH is also a way of leadership, of kingship. It's not only mercy and compassion as a sitting in a court. She sit in a kingship. So she participated in the creation of universe like Elohim. She added her own light, her own character to creation. We'll talk about it, how exactly it's, how you see it, how it's implemented. So she participated in creation. She participated in leadership. The opposite of him, him or she is just to distinguish. So Elohim would be said measure for measure. That's not her style. Her style is, she looked for something that's actually, she can very little to do with the animals, because she is for compassion and mercy. And so she doesn't walk by measure for measure. She walks with us, mainly. But she participates in creation, especially in man creation. So that's the whole style. She can rule the universe, she rule it, but she had also a certain goal. He said the king has, a king is a create, he rule, and he has a goal. So she created, she rule it in her fashion. Besides sitting in the heavenly court, she now created a kingship, leadership, and she led it also to the Sabbath. How is it possible that both Elohim and Yudavke came both to the Sabbath? Leave it to the next God in more detail. But we understand now that the verse number one the commandment number one in Ten Commandments said, man, there is a kingdom here. The kingdom is the creator who's to perform the two way he sit, he rule the world as Elohim, as a merciful one, and he finally give an order of execution of law order to the third line, and his verdict is not verdict of judgment in terms of a court, but how to the policy, what the policy of the universe should be. It's really kingship because it resembles amazingly, beautifully, unbelievable that the United States government is exactly like in that fashion. You see it right away. We, the United States, are the power. I am the United States people. We, the United States people, we form, that's number one, line number one. We form the Congress, where the two, we have different policies, we have two ways, many ways to conduct our affair. We can be liberal, we can be conservative, we can be Democrat, we can be Republican, we can have all this. All these are debated in the Congress. That's number two. So we, United States, form the Congress where the attribute or the two policies, different way of ruling are debated. They must debate and come to conclusion in order to issue an order to the White House. So United States is an example how it fits what the Torah says here. Unbelievable. No wonder United States is the first nation that recognize Noahide law as a basic of our moral fabric. That's the Declaration of the United States Congress under President Bush. Because the United States government is fit, it's compliant with the demand of the Torah to lead our universe in to power the people above, and the issue debate, and finally the kingship. Well, so we go back to now to Genesis. What is the Torah really telling us? The Torah telling us, think what the depths of what the Torah is telling us. He says, chapter 1:1, he said, man, you are under court. Okay, man, he says, look at nature, look at the sixth man. It looked to you, mishmash of galaxies, of black holes, nova exploding, nebulas, quantum physics. I don't see God here. Moses says, man, we look at this mishmash there. There is a government here. There is a purpose. Somebody created it. Who? Hashem, Elohim, created it for a purpose to lead the universe to the seventh day. In this way. Oh, you say, I look at nature. As Stephen Hawking says, I look at nature, I know nature, I know I know mathematical equations, I know relative physics. I actually understood the first man understood the black hole. I know the black matter, the white, the real matter, the atoms, the forces. I know so much about nature. I don't see God here. It reminds me, let's say a person comes to the United States and he says, let me see the United States government here. So they tell him, go to Washington, see the United States government. So I go to the United States, the person is a scientist. He looked there, the building, they call it Congress. So he take a measure, he'll measure the height, the height of the house, the width, they write down the detail. He actually form a formula exactly how the building is built. He touched the stone, he said, write down, he made from this granite, from this material. Then he go to the White House, he made the same calculation. He knows physics and mathematics. He can go in detail how the White House built. And then he come to you, sir, I spent so much time in Washington. I didn't see the United States government. I saw this and this, there's no government. They're stupid, you said. You didn't use the right tools. This house that you touch is full of a government. The government is nothing you can verify by physics and mathematics and equations. The government is in your mind, is a structure. Oh, he says, in that case, it's imaginary, it's a story. I don't believe in a story. A story you made up in mind. So you're telling me, yeah, you made up my mind. Try not to pay taxes in time and see if the United States government, IRS, is real or not. So said Moses says to the scientists. Scientists can say, I look at the black hole, so I don't see God here. So Moses says, fool, you are not looking for the right tools. I'm telling you there is a government. And another man said, well, government, it's imagination, it's a story. I don't see government in nature. Some other says, try it. You know, Mussolini, it reminds me, Mussolini, you know the story of Mussolini, the fascist. In 1942, he stood in the plaza on the balcony, I think in Milano there, and he shot brazenly with a hand, famous hand on the brazenly, flags around him, hundreds of thousands of people watching him that day, as he put his hand on his waist, look up in heaven and he says, if there is a God, kill me, he should kill me now. And everybody applauded, it was such a woman, he was God. No more, he was also a womanizer. Because if you fail idolatry, he said, you fail the next one, adultery. He was a great womanizer. I tell you that he's idolatry. Now, amazingly, almost the scholar says that almost by the day, in 1945, his body was hung upside down in the same plaza with his mistress, while those masses of people who hailed him passed by him, I quote New York Times, he spit it on his body, they cursed him, and actually the thorns remained apart. The man said, there is no God, so Moses says, try it. Hitler, he said, the Bible spoiled the Aryan nature. Even Christianity was bad for him, because it spoiled the natural spirit of him. He committed suicide. And the secretary said, why did he kill himself? Because he blamed his people. He was so disappointed that his own people didn't win the war, betrayed him. Actually, the last command he gave was to destroy Berlin. They didn't fulfill it. There is a book on that. There is God. There is a government around here. Try it. What they said. Try it. Don't try it. Better not. Itro, the first Noahide. The first Noahide, the Torah says in the book of Exodus, Noahide, Itro, this is before Mount Sinai revelation. The parsha of Itro start, and Itro heard what had happened, and he came to visit Moses, his son-in-law. He didn't convert, he remained Noahide. Some say he converted, but most commentaries say he did not convert. Maybe his children converted, but he did not. Because Moses told him, go back to your place after a while. So Vayishma Itro, Itro heard. So Rashi asked, what did he hear? He heard the split of the sea and the Pharaoh army was drowned in the sea of reed. You heard that. So the question is, what? You waited until now? After so many plagues in Egypt, so many miracles in Egypt, after the firstborn was killed, he now only now come and kill. That's what prompted him to come to Moses to become Noahide? And the answer is, Rashi says, and I think the Midrash says it explicitly. He said, wow. The guy, why were they drawn in the Red Sea? Pharaoh, who threw the children of the Israelites to the Nile. Such a cruel guy, took children, threw it to the Nile. Came the heavenly court, came the king of the universe, and drowned him. In the Red Sea. So measure for measure. Actually, it's a huge if you read carefully, there is a play between the pillar of fire and pillar of cloud. One of them present the Yudhev of K, one of them present the Lukim, and they move around. And anyhow, the heavenly court and the king of the universe. Put him down in measure for measure. And that measure for measure, prompted Yitro to come to Moses. First Noahide. So, one more word before I try to answer some questions. In summary, what we learned today only in bird view, that the self-creation, chapter 101, present universe, present universe ruled by the heavenly court, which has the universe, and also present universe as a kingship ruled by the heavenly court. So sometime, in fact, if you unite the two ideas together, sometimes the God rules the universe only through as a king, which means in that structure, you hear the policy, but this attribute says, or this attribute says, finally, issue a verdict. And sometimes a judge, a king, sometimes a king and a judge. In fact, there was only one time in a year that the two ideas are connected together. He's also a king and a judge. You know what day is it? That's Rosh Hashanah, at the beginning of the year. Holiday of the Rosh Hashanah is a day, anniversary of creation for all mankind. That's the anniversary of creation, the day the universe was created. Only on that day, and maybe Rabbi extended it up to Yom Kippur. But basically it's Rosh Hashanah idea. That's the only day in the year, only time of the year, if you include the 10 days, that we call God, we pray to God as a king and a judge. In fact, those two elements, kingship and judgment, are the basic element of Rosh Hashanah prayer of the Seder. Look at the whole prayer is based on that. So what we said here, so Rosh Hashanah is only one day we call Elohim. The rabbi says like this, all year long we call him the king who love Mishpat, who love us to do Mishpat. Amelech ha'ohev Mishpat. That's how we relate to him. The king who loved Mishpat. Amelech ha'ohev tzedakah u'mishpat. And Rosh Hashanah, we call him Amelech ha'mishpat. The king who became a Mishpat. As if the kingship now combined with the king ascended, the rabbi put it in the picture. The king ascended on the throne of judgment and is now ruled the universe as a judge. As if United States government, one time in a year, all year long, they debate, they hear the reality, the Congress, the lobby, this and this. And the verdict is molded by many, many factors. All year long, United States. But suppose one time a year, Rosh Hashanah, suppose, United States government suddenly changed the decoration. We are the supreme judge now. All of them were tired of judges. And now they sit and judge the universe, judge the United States, judge every citizen exactly by the law, exactly without any other connection to politics, to reality, to voting. They became supreme gods. So the king ascended on the throne on judgment. So one time a year, the king and the judge, the two ideas are connected. But all year long, we have the two at two. Sometimes yet both of these concepts go parallel time side by side. He's a king. He's also a judge. And that's chapter one. Okay. Let's see if you have some time to questions.